right? We are going to continue with electrode potential. Okay, as we have seen that in an electrolyte or in an electrochemical cell, oxidation and reduction definitely takes place. Okay, so we are going to understand what is electrode potential. Okay, so electrode potential is basically the electric potential difference set up between the metal and its solution. Okay, so between a metal and its solution, so let's take an example out here. Okay, let's say if we have let's say this is basically a solution which contains copper ions. Okay, and here we have a copper electrode which is dipped. Okay, so this is basically copper electrode and this is a solution of copper ions. Okay, now what can happen is that these copper ions can collide and just move on without any effect. Okay, no effect here. So since there is no effect, no potential will be set up. These electrode copper ions basically are colliding. I'm just taking copper as a just an example out here. So there is a possibility that the ions might strike the electrode without causing any reaction. Okay, for example, when we have inert electrodes, so this is one thing that can happen wherein we have no effect, so no electrode potential is set up. Okay, now we have the other thing, when in the same situation, okay, in the same situation we have copper ions here. These copper ions, what they do is they gain electrons and they get converted into copper. So they get converted or deposited as copper out here. So copper ions are gaining electrons and are getting deposited as copper here. Where are they getting these electrons from? Obviously this one. Okay, so they are gaining these electrons and they are getting converted into copper. So copper ions are gaining electrons and they are getting converted into copper. So due to loss of electrons, this will acquire a certain kind of positive charge. Okay, so here what is happening is, so if you look at it, there is gain of electrons. So when gain of electrons happens, what happens? Gain of electrons by the metal ions is basically a process of reduction. So this is basically becoming a process of reduction. Okay, so this is how the entire thing will happen. So the gain of electrons happens and hence this acquires, this metal starts depositing here. Okay, now we consider a situation when these ions, okay, or rather the copper in the metal itself, that kind of loses electrons. So this is losing electrons. Okay, this is losing electrons. Gain of electrons happens and hence we call it as reduction. Gain of electrons is happening here, so this is called reduction. And again, in this process, what is happening? Loss of electrons is happening at this site. So loss of electrons is happening at the electrode site, so this is called oxidation. Okay, this is basically resulting in oxidation. Now what is happening is that in this, since there is loss of electrons, so there is a negative charges that are accumulating here. Okay, there are negative charges which are getting accumulated here. So in this case, we will always find a difference. So the electric potential difference set up between the metal and its solution of ions. So there will always be a difference between the metal and its solution of ions. So here also there is a difference between the metal itself and the solution of ions. And this is what we call as electrode potential. Okay, I hope this makes clear. Okay, now what is oxidation potential? Very easy. The tendency of an electrode to lose electrons and getting oxidized is called the oxidation potential. So if an electrode is showing a tendency to lose electrons, okay, and get oxidized, for example, if we have a metal, let's say, okay, and this metal is showing a tendency to lose electrons, it is basically losing electrons. So what is happening is, let's say it has lost n number of electrons, and this becomes, so n number of electrons are liberated. Okay, so this is a metal which is getting, the metal is in the form of a solid, let's say the electrode, and it is losing electrode in the aqueous medium, and this is basically the number of electrons that it has lost. Now this will subsequently acquire the same amount of positive charge. So the metal which is in the form of a solid, that is electrode, it is losing electrons, and it's subsequently acquiring the same amount of positive charge. For example, we have seen in zinc, in the case of zinc, we have seen that zinc as a solid basically does undergo what? It undergoes formation of zinc ions and subsequently two electrons are released. So this is basically what is happening here, oxidation. This is called the oxidation process, okay. Losing of electrons is happening out here, okay. In the same way, reduction potential is the tendency of an electrode to gain electrons and get reduced. For example, if you see copper, that is Cu2+, what it does, it gains electrons, okay, and it becomes CuS. So this is basically coming from aqueous medium, the electrons are coming and getting added up here and it is forming this. So in this case we can write, let's say the metal ions M+Ne and number of electrons that they gain, they form the neutral metal in the form of solid, okay. Pretty much easy thing, okay. Now what is this electrode potential? Electrode potential, what does this electrode potential depend upon? Obviously the metal, it will depend upon the metal, as we can see in the form of zinc and copper, these are different metals, one is undergoing oxidation, the other one is going reduction, undergoing reduction. So metal, it will depend upon the metal and the ions, metal and the ions, it will also depend upon the concentration of ions in the solution. The concentration of ions in the solution. If you recall, when we were representing the electrolytic electrochemical cell, then we were actually representing it in the form of molar concentrations. So whatever is the molar concentration of the electrolyte that we have taken, that will be the same as the concentration of its ions. And obviously, as we have seen, that there is an influence of temperature. See, in metallic conductance, wherein we are dependent on the movement of free electrons, temperature has a negative effect. If you increase the temperature of a metal and you try to pass electricity through it, the resistance will increase, or we can say that the current will decrease. However, here if you increase the temperature, then the ions are going to move faster. So temperature definitely has an effect here. So these are the things on which the electrode potential depends, okay. You can take a snapshot of the same. Okay, some more theory part out here. What is the EMF of a cell or potential of a cell? We all know that electricity, whether it is in a circuit or whether it is in an electrolyte or whether it is in an electrochemical cell, it will flow due to a potential difference. Only if there is a potential difference, electricity will flow, otherwise electricity will not flow. So if in an electrochemical cell, we know that electricity is flowing, so there has to be an EMF that needs to be generated, which is basically the potential difference that needs to be generated. Okay, so how do we define the EMF of a cell? So first of all, we need to know that an electrochemical cell consists of two half cells. We all are aware that there are two different half cells that are there. In one, primarily oxidation takes place, and the other one, the reduction takes place. So one of them is the oxidation site and the other one is the reduction site. Okay, now electrodes have different reduction potentials. All these electrodes have different reduction potentials. What do we mean by this? That is, they have different tendency to lose or gain electrons. Okay, see, why are we talking about reduction potential rather than oxidation potential? Okay, we see it will be becoming very confusing if at one point of time we talk about a metal and we talk about its reduction potential, and at the same time we talk about another metal and we talk about its oxidation potential. Basically, these will be two different directions. We will be moving in two different directions. So it is always a standard and as a convention. Okay. So you have to note this, that for calculating EMF of a cell, the electrode potentials are always taken as reduction potentials. See, every element when it is taken as an electrode will have its own reduction potentials. So when we actually try to find out the EMF of a cell, we are concerned with the reduction potential. We can express it in oxidation potential, but then that's not the convention. By convention and by the normal standards, we are going to follow the reduction potential. So for calculating EMF of a cell, the electrode potentials are always taken as reduction potential, as a convention for both the electrodes. For both the electrodes, it's taken as a reduction potential. Okay, I hope this one's clear. We will never express EMF of a cell or the electrodes basically by the oxidation potential. Okay, so now when we come to the reduction potential, which is taken as a common factor between the two electrodes, okay, they have different tendencies to lose or gain electrons. So electrode which is having a higher reduction potential. Now understand this. The electrode which is having a higher reduction potential. Now what is reduction? Reduction is gain of electrons. Which means that the electrode which has a higher reduction potential will have a higher tendency to gain electrons, because reduction is what? Gaining of electrons. So the electrode which has a higher reduction potential will have a higher tendency to gain electrons, whereas the electrode having lower reduction potential will have lesser tendency to gain electrons, right? See, reduction potential means what? The potential to gain electrons. So the electrode which has a higher reduction potential will show a higher tendency to gain electrons, while the electrode which has a lower reduction potential will show a lower tendency to gain electrons. So as a result of this potential difference, because of this potential difference, there is a flow of electrons. There is a flow of electrons from the electrode having lower reduction potential to the electrode having higher reduction potential. So there is a flow of electrons from the electrode which has a lower reduction potential to the electrode which has a higher reduction potential. I hope this makes it clear. Okay. Why will this happen? Because the electrode which is having a higher reduction potential will have a higher tendency to gain the electrons, and the electrode which has a lower reduction potential will have a lower tendency to gain the electrons. So the electrons will always flow from the electrode which has a lower reduction potential to the electrode which has a higher reduction potential, and this is what generates the EMF of the cell. Okay, so EMF is what? EMF is the difference between the electrode potentials, which are taken only as reduction potentials. Potentials of the two electrodes constituting an electrochemical cell is called the electromotive force. So in this case, we can say that the reduction potentials are taken. Okay, oxidation potentials are not concerned or not considered, because that will create a confusion. If we take the reduction potential and the oxidation potential, then that will create a confusion, and this is the reason why we are taking the reduction potential as a standard. So the difference between the electrode potentials of two electrodes constituting an electrochemical reaction is called the electromotive force or cell potential of a cell. It is called the electromotive force or cell potential of a cell. So this is the driving force of a cell reaction, which is expressed in volts. This is the driving force. Again, let's come to this. What is the electromotive force of a cell, or what is the EMF of a cell? EMF is basically electromotive force. Electromotive force is what? It is electromotive, the difference between the electrode potentials. Now, what is electrode potential? Electrode potential, here we are talking about the reduction potential, the tendency of an element or an electrode to get reduced. Okay, which means the tendency it shows towards gaining electrons. So obviously, the one which has higher reduction potential will be the one which is drawing the electrons towards itself. So the flow of electrons will always be from the electrode which is at a lower reduction potential towards the electrode which has a higher reduction potential. So where will the current flow? Since the flow of electrons is from this one to this one, current will flow from a higher reduction potential to a lower reduction potential, because conventionally current is taken to be in opposite direction to the flow of electrons. Okay, so the difference between the electrode potentials of two electrodes that is constituting an electromotive cell is called the electromotive force. This is called the EMF or cell potential of a cell. This is a cell potential of a cell. So this is the driving force of all reactions. This is the driving force of electrochemical reactions, which is expressed in volts. We all know that batteries are basically expressed in volts. I hope this clears the conception of the EMF or the potential of a cell. We will cover more to it in the next slide. So you can take a snapshot of the same while we move on to the next slide. Okay, some more theory part out here. What is the EMF of a cell or potential of a cell? We all know that electricity, whether it is in a circuit or whether it is in an electrolyte or whether it is in an electrochemical cell, it will flow due to a potential difference. Only if there is a potential difference, electricity will flow, otherwise electricity will not flow. So if in an electrochemical cell we know that electricity is flowing, so there has to be an EMF that needs to be generated, which is basically the potential difference that needs to be generated. Okay, so how do we define the EMF of a cell? So first of all, we need to know that an electrochemical cell consists of two half cells. We all are aware that there are two different half cells that are there. In one, primarily oxidation takes place, and the other one the reduction takes place. So one of them is the oxidation site and the other one is the reduction site. Okay, now electrodes have different reduction potentials. All these electrodes have different reduction potentials. What do we mean by this? That is, they have different tendency to lose or gain electrons. Okay, see, why are we talking about reduction potential rather than oxidation potential? Okay, we see it will be becoming very confusing if at one point of time we talk about a metal and we talk about its reduction potential, and at the same time we talk about another metal and we talk about its oxidation potential. Basically, these will be two different directions. We will be moving in two different directions. So it is always a standard and as a convention. Okay, so you have to note this, that for calculating EMF of a cell, the electrode potentials are always taken as reduction potentials. See, every element when it is taken as an electrode will have its own reduction potentials. So when we actually try to find out the EMF of a cell, we are concerned with the reduction potential. We can express it in oxidation potential, but then that's not the convention. By convention and by the normal standards, we are going to follow the reduction potential. So for calculating EMF of a cell, the electrode potentials are always taken as reduction potential as a convention for both the electrodes. For both the electrodes, it's taken as a reduction potential. Okay, I hope this one's clear. We will never express EMF of a cell or the electrodes basically by the oxidation potential. Okay, so now when we come to the reduction potential, which is taken as a common factor between the two electrodes, okay, they have different tendencies to lose or gain electrons. So electrode which is having a higher reduction potential, now understand this, the electrode which is having a higher reduction potential. Now what is reduction? Reduction is gain of electrons, which means that the electrode which has a higher reduction potential will have a higher tendency to gain electrons, because reduction is what? Gaining of electrons. So the electrode which has a higher reduction potential will have a higher tendency to gain electrons, whereas the electrode having lower reduction potential will have lesser tendency to gain electrons, right? See, reduction potential means what? The potential to gain electrons. So the electrode which has a higher reduction potential will show a higher tendency to gain electrons, while the electrode which has a lower reduction potential will show a lower tendency to gain electrons. So as a result of this potential difference, because of this potential difference, there is a flow of electrons. There is a flow of electrons from the electrode having lower reduction potential to the electrode having higher reduction potential. So there is a flow of electrons from the electrode which has a lower reduction potential to the electrode which has a higher reduction potential. I hope this makes it clear. Okay. Why will this happen? Because the electrode which is having a higher reduction potential will have a higher tendency to gain the electrons, and the electrode which has a lower reduction potential will have a lower tendency to gain the electrons. So the electrons will always flow from the electrode which has a lower reduction potential to the electrode which has a higher reduction potential, and this is what generates the EMF of the cell. Okay, so EMF is what? EMF is the difference between the electrode potentials, which are taken only as reduction potentials. Potentials of the two electrodes constituting an electrochemical cell is called the electromotive force. So in this case, we can say that the reduction potentials are taken. Okay? Oxidation potentials are not concerned or not considered, because that will create a confusion. If we take the reduction potential and the oxidation potential, then that will create a confusion, and this is the reason why we are taking the reduction potential as a standard. So the difference between the electrode potentials of two electrodes constituting an electrochemical reaction is called the electromotive force or cell potential of a cell. It is called the electromotive force or cell potential of a cell. So this is the driving force of a cell reaction, which is expressed in volts. This is the driving force. Again, let's come to this. What is the electromotive force of a cell, or what is the EMF of a cell? EMF is basically electromotive force. Electromotive force is what? It is electromotive, the difference between the electrode potentials. Now, what is electrode potential? Electrode potential, here we are talking about the reduction potential, the tendency of an element or an electrode to get reduced. Okay, which means the tendency it shows towards gaining electrons. So obviously, the one which has higher reduction potential will be the one which is drawing the electrons towards itself. So the flow of electrons will always be from the electrode which is at a lower reduction potential towards the electrode which has a higher reduction potential. So where will the current flow? Since the flow of electrons is from this one to this one, current will flow from a higher reduction potential to a lower reduction potential, because conventionally current is taken to be in opposite direction to the flow of electrons. Okay, so the difference between the electrode potentials of two electrodes that is constituting an electromotive cell is called the electromotive force. This is called the EMF or cell potential of a cell. This is a cell potential of a cell. So this is the driving force of all reactions. This is the driving force of electrochemical reactions, which is expressed in volts. We all know that batteries are basically expressed in volts. I hope this clears the conception of the EMF or the potential of a cell. We will cover more to it in the next slide. So you can take a snapshot of the same while we move on to the next slide. Okay, some more points about the EMF. Now we have seen generally that we generally express electrode potentials in the reduction form. So we are expressing, or conventionally we are taking standard reduction potentials. So it will make things confusing if we have oxidation potentials in place and reduction potentials as well. So might as well consider everything on the same scale of reduction potential, rather than taking one at oxidation and then taking the other one at reduction potentials. So all of them are considered on the same base of standard reduction potential. Now generally it will hardly have any difference. Now let's say if I were to say that the standard reduction potential of zinc is minus 0.76 volts. So if I say that, what will be the standard oxidation potential? The standard oxidation potentials will be 0.76 volt. That's the only thing that will happen. Okay, so standard reduction potential of zinc is minus 0.76 volts, whereas the standard oxidation potential of zinc will be plus 0.76 volts. Okay, so now let's move on to the EMF of the cell. More points on the EMF. Now what is the cell potential or EMF? Why does it arise? Basically, it arises due to the differences of the tendencies. What are the differences in the tendencies of the two ions to get reduced? It is basically due to the difference in the tendencies of the two ions to get reduced. Okay, so we have something called as the EMF, reduction potential of the substance that undergoes reduction minus reduction potential of the substance that undergoes oxidation. EMF is what? Reduction potential of the substance that undergoes reduction minus reduction potential of the substance that undergoes oxidation. So reduction potential of cathode minus reduction potential of anode. So reduction potential of cathode minus reduction potential of anode. So we have a cell here. We have the reduction potential of cathode minus reduction potential of anode. Again, cathode is always represented on the right side and anode is represented on the left side. That is something that we have already seen. So we can say that, see, the reason why we are representing cathode is because reduction primarily happens at the cathode and oxidation basically happens at the anode. Okay, so the reduction, this will be E of cathode minus EMF of the anode. Okay, so reduction potential at the right hand side minus reduction potential at the left hand side. We can also write it in this way. So EMF of a cell is also defined as the potential difference between the electrodes of the cell. Potential difference between the electrodes of the cell when either no or very negligible amount of current flows through the cell. Okay, when either or very negligible amount of current is actually flowing through the cell, then we are calculating the EMF of the cell. So we will say that this is the EMF of the cell when when hardly any current flows through the cell. We can say that it is hardly, no current at all is flowing through the cell. That is the EMF of the cell, and that is the potential difference between the electrodes. So potential difference between the cathode and the anode is basically the EMF of a cell, electromotive force. Okay, standard reduction potential is its factor on which it depends. We are going to calculate everything on the same base of standard reduction potential. Okay, I hope this makes the EMF concept a little clearer. Okay, you can take a snapshot of the same. Okay, we are going to learn the procedure of measuring the standard electrode potential. Okay, so in this slide we are going to learn the procedure, entire procedure of measuring the standard electrode potential. So let's look at how do we start. Okay, so what is the process, how to measure standard electrode potential? So what we take is 1 molar solution of an electrolyte.
we generally take one molar solution of an electrolyte, and then what we do is we convert it into a metal electrode. Okay, one the electrolyte that we are taking, the metal for which we need to know the standard electrode potential, we are taking one molar solution of its electrolyte. Okay, and the metal electrode is taken. Okay, so this will basically what one molar solution will give the aqueous ions in the ions the aqueous form, and this is the metal electrode. So this is the metal ion and electrode. This is basically the ions that are getting formed, and this is the metal. That's how we will represent. We generally represent the entire electrochemical cell, but if we are representing only the cathode part or the anode part, then we represent it in this way: the ions that are formed here and the metal electrode. So the ions can be either cations or anions, and depending on that we can either have the anode or the cathode. So that's how it is represented. So one molar solution of the electrolyte is taken, the metal electrode is taken, the above or cell is connected to sheath. Okay, so this above cell, this is basically half cell. Okay, because only the half reaction is getting represented here. Obviously there has to be an other half, since this is an electrochemical reaction. If there is an oxidation process, the other half has to be reduction. If this is a reduction process, then the other half has to be an oxidation. So this is the half cell that is happening here. So what is the other half? The other half is basically the standard hydrogen electrode that we are going to take. So we are going to take the other half as standard hydrogen electrode via a salt bridge. So the salt bridge will be there. We don't have to worry much about salt bridge, because any which ways it is consisting of inert electrolytes, and those electrolytes are just going to cover up for the ions that are getting lost in the process, so that the reaction is not coming to a halt temporarily. Because of accumulation of ions in the respective electrodes, there is a possibility, as we have seen earlier, that the chemical or electrolytic chemical reaction can come to a halt temporarily. And hence, in order to ensure that that doesn't happen, we are using a salt bridge. And salt bridge, we don't have to worry much about it, because it will just compensate for the ions which are getting accumulated, so that the accumulation of ions doesn't happen, and the electrolytic production or the entire process keeps on continuing. Okay, so we will talk about the salt bridge. This, so look at this. Okay, this is basically, these are two beakers, and we have solutions out here. Now let's say if we were to determine zinc, we are taking two examples here. One is copper and the other one is zinc. Why are we taking zinc and copper? Because in both the cases the other half is going to be standard hydrogen electrode. Now it depends how the standard hydrogen electrode is going to behave. Now the standard hydrogen electrode, in case of zinc, okay, in case of zinc, the reduction potential of zinc, basically zinc has greater tendency to lose electrons than than hydrogen here. So the zinc has got greater tendency to lose electrons than hydrogen, which means that the reduction potential of hydrogen is higher than the reduction potential of zinc. Are we clear on this one? Okay, reduction potential means what? The reduction process. Okay, what is reduction process? Gain of electrons. So if we say that zinc has greater tendency to lose electrons than hydrogen, it means that the electrode potential or the standard reduction potential, the SRP, the standard reduction potential of hydrogen will be higher than that of zinc. So we can say that the SRP of hydrogen is higher than the SRP of zinc, because zinc here will show a tendency to get oxidized. It is going to show a tendency to get, or rather lose electrons. Okay, so zinc has a higher tendency to lose electrons. As we have seen, hydrogen can act, as it is selected as a standard hydrogen electrode, has a possibility of behaving both as a cathode and as an anode. Okay, so this is a salt bridge that we have, and here we have one molar of zinc solution. Now this can be ZnSO4, zinc sulfate. So this is one molar of zinc solution, and obviously this is the entire arrangement of the standard hydrogen electrode. Here the hydrogen gas are bubbled, and this is one molar of HCl solution. This is one molar of HCl solution. As we have seen, that is one molar of the electrolyte, one molar solution of the electrolyte. So one molar solution of HCl and one molar solution of ZnSO4. Okay, now what will happen, since zinc has got higher potential to lose electrons than hydrogen, what will happen? The electrons will start flowing. okay, the current will be created. So there will be a potential difference that will be generated, which will be measured by the voltmeter. Now, one thing that we have to keep in mind is that the positive side of the voltmeter needs to be connected to the positive side, and the negative side needs to be connected to the negative side. Now, how do we determine which is the negative side and which is the positive side? We know that the right hand side is the positive side. I'm sorry. The right hand side is the cathode side, which is negative side, and the left hand side is the positive side. Okay. So when we are connecting this voltmeter, we have to be very sure about the connection. The voltmeter connection has to be applied in such a way that the positive side of the voltmeter gets connected to the positive electrode and the negative side gets connected to the negative electrode. Otherwise, the reading will not be showing. Okay, there will be no reading that will be shown. In spite of a potential of electric or the potential being created for the flow of electricity, there will be no reading that will be shown by this. So we have to be careful about that. Otherwise, no voltmeter reading will be shown. So let's say where we are getting a voltmeter reading of 0.76 volts. Okay, so we are getting a voltmeter reading here. Okay, now we will try and understand this and calculate this. So we know here hydrogen is acting as what? Hydrogen is acting as the anode. Okay, so she, or rather the standard hydrogen electrode here, is acting as the anode. So what will happen here in the anode? The electrons are lost by the by whatever the electrode is. So here we have the hydrogen electrode, so it is losing electrons. Okay, okay, so now we will come here as the EMF of the cell. What will be the EMF of the cell? EMF of the cell is written like this. Okay, we have the sign like this. This is called the EMF of the cell. Now EMF of the cell, as we have studied in the earlier slide, it will be EMF of the side at the right, okay, minus at the left. Okay, so right minus the left. Okay, so this will be how it will be. So right is what? Right, EMF of the right minus EMF of the left. As we have already seen, that right side will always be the cathode side and left side will always be the anode side. Okay, so in this case, what will happen? This will be the right side, that is the cathode side here. Sorry, that is the anode side. I'm so sorry. That is the anode side. Okay, so here it will be right side minus left side. So here this is the right one and this is the left one. The confusion happens when you are teaching. Okay, when then your right, left, and this basically. Okay, so this is the right side, which is basically behaving as the anode, and this is the left side, which is basically behaving as the cathode. Okay, so this is the right side, which is behaving as the anode, and this is the right, left side, which is behaving as the cathode. So whichever is behaving as the anode, okay, here it is the anode and here is that the cathode. So what is happening is right side minus left side. So here we have H plus and H2. Okay, H plus and H2 is what is happening here, and here's zinc ions and zinc electrode, hydrogen ions and hydrogen electrode, zinc ions and zinc electrode. So here we have 0.00, because we know the electrode potential of hydrogen is always 0.00. So 0.00 volts, and this will be 0.76 volts minus, let's say we are not aware of this. How will we calculate this then? Okay, sorry, this will be for eta, and this will be E. The electrode potential of zinc will now be obviously 0. So if this, if we keep this here by transposing the terms, we will get minus 0.76. okay, so this is the reduction potential of zinc, that is minus 0.76 volts. This is the reduction potential of zinc. Okay, why? Because reduction is, this is the standard reduction potential of zinc. Okay, now if we come to copper, what do we see here? We have copper here dipped in again 1 molar solution of copper sulfate, and in this case, why this is placed in this side? Because in this case, hydrogen has greater tendency to lose the electrons than copper. In this case, hydrogen has greater tendency to lose the electrons than copper. So hydrogen starts losing the electrons, and the electrons are actually flowing from this to this. Okay, so oxidation occurs at the hydrogen side. So here the oxidation is occurring. The oxidation is occurring. This is the oxidation cell and this is the reduction cell. The electrons are gained there. Okay, in the same way, the electrons are being lost here. Okay, and this electrons are being gained here. So oxidation is occurring at this side and reduction at this side. Okay, so this will be the oxidation side, okay, anode, and this will be the cathode side. Okay, so the cell potential has been measured as, so here also we apply a voltmeter. okay, then again we have a salt bridge. So here if we have the EMF of the cell is equal to EMF of the right part minus EMF of the left part, what do we have in the right part? Copper ions and the copper electrode. What do we have in the left part? Hydrogen ions and the hydrogen electrode. Okay, so what we have is 0.34 as the measured value, and in this place we know that this will be 0.00. okay, so what do we get here? 0.34. okay, 0.34, that is positive. So standard electrode potential of copper is 0.34 and standard electrode potential of zinc is -0.76. so this is the arrangement how we actually calculate by comparing it to Xi or the hydrogen electrode. So it depends. In some reactions it is used as a cathode, and in some reactions it's used as the anode. So wherever we have a tendency, when the metal is showing a tendency of losing electrons, with a more higher tendency to lose electrons, then the metal will be coming on the left hand side, and when it will be showing a tendency to gain electrons as compared to hydrogen, then it will be coming on the right hand side. Okay, so loss of electrons definitely is the oxidation side. So this is the oxidation side here. Okay, oxidation side means anode. Okay, so in this case it is going to act as the anode. This is the oxidation side. So this is going to act as the anode, and this is going to act as the cathode, where the reduction happens, where the gain of electrons happens. In the same way here it is going to act as the oxidation side, that is the anode. This is the oxidation side where the, so if you look and compare this, this zinc here is losing electrons. Losing electrons is a process of oxidation. So here zinc is going to act as the anode, and here it is gain of electrons. So here it is going to act as the cathode. Okay, so this is going to, I am making a mistake here. Okay, this is going to act as the cathode. Okay, so here it is going to act as the cathode, and here it is going to act as the anode, and this is going to act as the cathode. Why? Because it is the site where electrons are going to get gained, and this is the site where electrons are going to get lost. So just a quick comparison here. In case of a metal which has a reduction potential, higher than hydrogen, in case of a metal which has a reduction potential higher than that of hydrogen, what will happen? In that case, reduction means gain of electrons. So in this case, hydrogen is going to gain the electrons. Okay, so in this case, what will happen? We have to keep hydrogen on the right hand side. So in this case, zinc has a lower reduction potential than hydrogen. Is this understood? If a metal has a reduction potential lower than that of hydrogen, it will obviously be placed on the left hand side as the anode, because hydrogen is in that case going to gain the electrons. It will show a higher tendency to gain the electrons and get reduced. So in that case, Xi will act as the cathode side, and this will act as the anode side. Okay, and in the case of copper, what is happening here? Copper has a lower tendency than hydrogen to gain electrons, which means that the standard reduction potential of copper is greater than that of hydrogen. See, in this case, if we, in the previous case, what is happening? The standard reduction potential of hydrogen is higher than the standard reduction potential of zinc. And in this case, in the second case, the standard reduction potential of copper is higher than the standard reduction potential of hydrogen. Okay, are we clear on this one? So in that is how we are going to place the cell, basically, because our cell depends. So if I have to represent the cell here, this will be the exact representation of the cell. Okay, Zn 2 plus. Okay, zinc electrode, zinc ions. What are these ions? Zinc ions which are formed here. Okay, this is a zinc electrode. Then we have the salt bridge. Then this is the hydrogen ions, and this is basically hydrogen at 1 atmosphere pressure, and platinum electrode, of course. Okay, if we were to represent this one again, Xi will be represented here as the anode. Okay, this will be the anode. Platinum, hydrogen at 1 atmospheric pressure. This is the hydrogen ions which are formed. Okay, and this is the salt bridge, and this is the copper ions which are formed, and this is the copper electrode. Okay, so this is how we have represented it. So the thing is very simple. If a metal basically has a higher standard reduction potential than hydrogen, then in order to measure it, we will have to keep it on the if this is having, if hydrogen is has this, then hydrogen will be placed on the right, and if it is higher than hydrogen, then hydrogen will be placed on the left. Okay, so this is how we will calculate the reaction. EMF is basically the electrode potential at the right minus the electrode potential at left. So electrode potential at right is basically here is what the, this is the cathode part, this is the anode part. If we subtract it, if we don't, obviously we don't know it when we need to calculate it. So what we get is the electrode potential of zinc, which is coming as minus 0.76, and hence we can just say that reduction potential of zinc is minus 0.76, whereas we know the reduction potential of hydrogen is 0.00. So obviously zinc has a lower electrode potential than hydrogen, which means that the reduction potential of hydrogen is higher than that of zinc, which means that the electrons will flow towards hydrogen when both are used as electrodes, when zinc and hydrogen are used as electrodes. In this case, if you see, the value that we have calculated is plus 0.34 for copper. So if copper has plus 0.34, we know that the standard reduction potential or basically the electrode potential of hydrogen is 0.00, which means that copper has a higher potential, electrode potential than hydrogen, which means that the reduction potential of hydrogen, the reduction, if we consider the reduction potential is what? The tendency to lose electrons, the tendency to gain electrons. So the reduction potential of copper is more than that of hydrogen, and that's the reason the electrons are flowing in this way. Okay, so this is how we can determine the electrode potential of a particular electrode, and it's a very important thing. Please take a snapshot of this and have a good understanding of this by referring to your books. If still there is a confusion, please feel free to post your comments so that I can take this further. Okay, so finally we are now coming on to the electrochemical series, okay, basically which is the main series that we have in order to refer. Okay, so electrochemical series is basically a series which has been arranged in a particular fashion. So we will understand what is it basically. Electrochemical series is referring to the standard reduction potential or standard electrode potential, both are one and the same thing, with reference to the standard hydrogen electrode, or we can also say the normal hydrogen electrode. So arrangement of electrons in order of decreasing electrode potential values. So this is basically arrangement of electrons in order of decreasing electrode potential values is called electrochemical series, which means that we are arranging it in the order of decreasing electrode potential values. The one at the top, which is fluorine, will have the highest electrode potential, that is plus 2.87. The one at the bottom, that is lithium, will have the lowest electrode potential, that is minus 3.05. Now, what does it mean basically? Try and understand the electrode potential thing. So here, since the electrode potential is the lowest, okay, which means that the standard reduction potential is the lowest, which means this will show a tendency to lose electrons, right? If I compare this with iron here, so or let's say a copper here, so it will show a tendency to lose electrons to this, okay? So all these will show a tendency to lose electrons, and the ones which show tendency to lose electrons, okay, the ones which show a tendency to lose electrons are basically what? Are basically reducing agents, right? They are reducing agents, show increasing tendency to lose electrons. And here if we go in this way, they show increasing tendency to gain electrons. They will show an increasing tendency to gain electrons, and they will show an increasing tendency to lose electrons. Okay, so in this case, relative strengths of oxidizing agent and reducing agents, these are substances which have lower electrode potentials are stronger reducing agents, while substances which have higher electrode potentials are stronger oxidizing agents. The ones which have lower electrode potentials, obviously these are the lower electrode potentials, are stronger reducing agents. Okay, So the ones which have lower electrode potentials, substances which have lower electrode potentials are stronger reducing agents. Why are they reducing agents? Because they are supplying the electrons. Okay, the lower is the electrode potential, the higher will be the tendency to supply electrons, which means standard reduction potential is low. If the standard reduction potential is low, if we recall, the one which has a lower standard reduction potential is always placed on the left hand side, because it will show a tendency to lose electrons. Okay, so this will show a tendency to lose electrons. It means that it is a good reducing agent because it is providing electrons. Okay, these will show a strong tendency to gain electrons. Okay, so they will be the weakest reducing agents. They will be strong oxidizing agents. Okay, so substances which have lower electrode potentials are stronger reducing agents, while substances which have higher electrode potentials are strong oxidizing agents. So if you look at this, lithium, sodium, calcium, this is not the entire electrochemical series. Electrochemical series is a huge series which you can look up in your books or other reference materials. Okay, you can also download it from the Google. But this is some of the common elements which are in use in particular. Okay, now we'll try and understand the applications of it. So the first application is basically determining which is a strong oxidizing agent and which is a strong reducing agent. So the ones which will be found at the lower part of the table with low electrode potentials are the ones which are strong reducing agents. Okay, and they are weak oxidizing agents. The ones which will be found at the top of the table with higher electrode potentials will be the ones which are weak reducing agents, however strong oxidizing agents. Okay, so we'll continue with more applications to this one.